ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. من علامات التيه يا إخوة في الأمة، the signs of being lost as an ummah, that we're doing exactly like Bani Israel as an ummah, wandering, like we said, going in circles, not understanding the wisdom behind the ritual. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he initiated for us Siyam Ashura, the fasting of Ashura, which is on the 10th of Al-Muharram, the hadith explicitly indicate that this is a day when we as an ummah should connect with the earlier Muslims. And if we read the narration of Imam Ahmad of the hadith, this is the day on which the Ark of Noah finally landed on the 10th of Al-Muharram. And Nuh alayhi salam fasted it, shukran lillah, showing gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for najatihi, being saved with his family. And if we read hadith ibn Abbas fil Bukhari wa Muslim, that this is the day on which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Bani Israel from the Pharaoh. So here we are connecting with the previous umam who held the same beliefs like ours, Tawheed. Qawm Nuh, those who were saved on the ark, كانوا على التوحيد. They believed in the monotheism. Bani Israel, who were with Musa, كانوا على التوحيد. Yeah, there is a question regarding the quality of their tawheed, but they are still Muslims, like many Muslims now. Yet, you find the Shia, which is a sect in Islam, do take that day out of context. They really make it a day of disunity. So it's supposed to be a day of unity for what? For us as an ummah, and a day when you are given hope. Because Allah saved Nuh on a ship. Allah can save us too. We're going through a very hard time. Allah can save us too. A hope, hope. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa and Bani Israel. That's a day when you what? You're supposed what? To have what? Bring hope. But what they do, they turn it into a day of grief, and they go after an event that happened to the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, al-Husayn, which happened on this day, the day of Ashura. So they make it a day of mourning, a day of grief, and they express their grief and mourning in a way that is out of context. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, He says, الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا What? إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Those when they are inflicted with a calamity, they say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا نَسْتَرْجِعَ إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ This is what they call the positive grief. You say certain words from the Sunnah that can help you stay patient. And later on, inshallah, you develop the servitude of al-ridha, that you accept qada Allah wa qadari. But when you're inflicted with a calamity, you don't have to accept it right away. That's not normal. But the normal course of action, that you're hit, you're shocked, the first servitude you're supposed to practice, exercise, is patience. But accepting it, no, you don't have to accept it. You do not have to accept it. ولذلك the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he saw Umm Salama sitting in front of the grave of her husband, and he saw her crying, he said to her, إنما الصبر عند الصدمة الأولى. Exercising patience when you're immediately being struck with the shock. Or when you're being shocked with the calamity. Suppose, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ عَلَى طُولِ إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ الحمد لله. لله ما أخذ ولله ما أعطى كل شيء عنده أجل المسمى. قدر الله وما شاء فعل. You accepting it is not a condition, by the way. Don't think that, oh, I have to accept قدر الله. Not immediately. The servitude for rida normally comes what? Later. Then grief is a natural. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when his son Ibrahim died, he stood next to him and he said, إِنَّ الْقَلْبَ لَا يَحْزَنْ The heart grieves. وَإِنَّ الْعَيْنَ لَتَدْمَعْ And tears will come down too. But لا ولا نقول ما يحزن الرب ما يغضب الرب وإن لفراقك يا إبراهيم لمحزنون ولكن لا نقول ما يغضب الرب And I'm so in grief. I'm grieving for your death, O Ibrahim. This is Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So his heart is saddened by the death of his son, tears are coming down, but I'm not gonna say anything that what shows dissatisfaction with the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu was killed the year 61 after Hijrah. I mean, until now, you did not accept qadr Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the rida? We said patience is when you what? I mean, you grieving maybe for 1 year, that's fine. Why don't we do the same thing for Uthman? Uthman was killed. Umar, what about Umar? Umar was killed where? Leading the salah. So you're not supposed to do that. And that's why, ya ikhwa, it's a bid'ah to have an annual sanawiyya. Gullak, ana ba'amal as-sanawiyya bta'at mean? I'm doing the annual what? The annual commemoration of the death of my... These things are in back home. 40 yom, gullak, after 40 days or after... Hal hada min as-sunnah? This is from the sunnah? Walidhak al-aza'. How many days aza'? Offering condolences. 3 days, khalas. Turn the chapter, move on. Accept قدر الله and move on. ف not only they grieve in a way that is out of context, in a way that is, and nobody tells you that you grieve, that you go and you hit yourself with chains and you bleed, and what is this? And you sit in a gathering, oh, if you see their ceremony on that day is out of this world. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أنا بريء. I disown الحالقة والصالقة, the one who shaved her head, والشاقة, the one who shaves his head, or the one who, if she's a female or male, for because of grieving. الصالقة, the one who cries loud. والشاقة, the one who tear the clothes. They don't only do this, they do what? فين السنة؟ ليس منا من شق الجيوب, he is not one of us. حديث البخاري ومسلم وفي كتبهم, this hadith actually in their literature. He is not one of us, the one who tear the cloth out of grief. لطم الخدود, slap the cheeks. ودعا بدعوى الجاهلية, that he says, you know, words of jahiliyyah. Not only this, ya ikhwa, they go after Ahlul Sunnah as if Ahlul Sunnah are the people who really killed Al-Husayn. And this is a misconception that actually a lot of Shi'i Muslims don't know. And this is where, ya ikhwa, the purpose and the objective of this is education, so that you can actually educate them, because a lot of them are just blind followers of these amaim, of these people with the imamat. They sit in front of them, they have no knowledge, and they are brought up in such an environment, and that's why they deserve da'wah. They should give them da'wah, should help them understand that that is not really the case. Actually, may not come to this today, but actually tomorrow or in this setting today or tomorrow, I will give you the reference from Kutub al-Shia, from the literature of al-Shia, that they believe that the people of al-Kufa are the sole responsible party for the death, for the murder, for the massacre of al-Husayn. They actually believe that. The early Shi'i believe that. They believe that. And the context of the story indicate that. Inshallah, if you don't mind, let's in 15-20 minutes share with you the story of the massacre of al-Husayn, a portion of it, and maybe leave the commentary and till tomorrow, inshallah, after Fajr, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Whatever I'm sharing with you right now comes from, here is my sources, and this is the standard Sunni reading of this event. Al-Bidayah wal-Nihayah ibn Kathir, Ibn Hajar, العسقلاني, the author of Fathul Bari. So this is not my, I didn't make up that stuff yet. I'm just copying it from the books. الحافظ الذهبي وابن تيمية. Both are the standard يعني Sunni position on this event. So I'm sharing with you their writing. Of course, Shia al-Rawafid, they have their own version. They don't follow these scholars. And they base their reading of the event on a historian who is known by Abu Mikhnaf Lut ibn Yahya. Abu Mikhnaf Lut ibn Yahya. Al-Rajul himself, he says, I'm a Rafidi, I'm يعني, and a lot of the stuff that he compiled is simply fake. He made up stuff. First of all, as Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the saved sect, the victorious group, we ask Allah to be of them, Ya Rabb al-Alameen. ما هي عقيدتنا في آل البيت؟ What is our belief concerning آل البيت؟ First of all, do we know what آل البيت means? What آل البيت means? آل is a derivative, derives from أهل. So أصل الكلمة, the origin of the word is أهل. أهل means إيه؟ The family. يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم. So أهل الرجل, آل الرجل, أهل الرجل هم الذين are those to whom يقول, إليهم يقول, وإليه يقولون. يعني they turn together, they get together, الآل. What is our عقيدة? Because you see, they base their beliefs, Shia al-Rawafid, on that particular issue, that we love the family of the Prophet, as if we don't do it, as if Ahl al-Sunnah don't do it. And this is again a misconception. First of all, let's identify who are Ahl al-Nabi. يا إخوة في الصلاة, اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد. Every صلاة, right? كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم. وإيه؟ Then what? اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد. Every صلاة. For there is no way that we have no respect for the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no way. But we're in the middle, like any other thing. You see, there are two extremes. There are people out there who say the family of the Prophet, Al Nabi, are like any other family. Nothing special about them. To the extent that some of them actually go after them, and we do have a sect in the Ummah called the Nawasib. Nasabu Aliya. Adu Ali. In support of Uthman. But then there is another sect in the Ummah, but Alhamdulillah they are dying out. In the day of Ashura, they show what? They show joy. They actually, and you find that they fabricated some ahadith about cooking food, and whoever gives his family food on Ashura, and they end up doing what? سموه الكحل هذا. وكل هذا في العراق. For those are two extremes. And the other extreme to this is what? Is you say Ali is Ilah, is God. Ali al-Nabi, whether he's the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or what? الإمام, without him he cannot go to Jannah. He tells the thing be and it will be. That you attribute divinity to the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You see, we're in the middle. We believe that they are the most respected family in the face of this earth, and we love them. And we love those who love them. And we resent those who resent them. But again, our love for them does not give them a status above They're human beings. They are regular people. Amongst them are the righteous. Amongst them are the wicked. Isn't Abu Lahab from the family of the Prophet? Amongst them are the good, and amongst them are those who are. If he's a Muslim and he's good, that gives him double love for us because he's from the family of the Prophet. Imagine this, if he was a companion of the Prophet, that is a triple standard for us, triple love. But again, our love for them does not qualify us to do what? To give them a status over their actual status. And I'll share with you, ikhwa, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and hadith al-Sahihain. Just to show you that this has been always the footsteps. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu says, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ وَالْحَدِيثِ الصَّحِيحَيْنِ By the one in whose hand my soul is, لَقَرَابَةُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ أَصْلِ قَرَابَتِي The lineage, the family members of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are more beloved to me than my own family. وقصة إسلام قحافة the father of Abu Bakr يا إخوة on the day of the فتح مكة he was not yet a Muslim so he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or actually the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to him because he was so old and his beard was so white and big, huge And he accepted Islam. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, ya ikhwa, started crying. Started weeping. For Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa looked at him and he said, What is wrong with you, Abu Bakr? Your father is accepting Islam. Qala Rasulullah, he said, By Allah, O Messenger of Allah, wadattu an yakuna hadha ammuk. I wish this was your uncle, Abu Talib. That's his father. Because he knows that the Prophet ﷺ really wanted what? Wanted his uncle to accept Islam. Umar ibn Sa'd fi al-Tabaqat rawa anna Umar qala lil-Abbas yawma aslam that Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu said to al-Abbas the day that He became a Muslim. Al-Abbas is the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the father of Abdullah. Huh? Abdullah ibn Abbas. فقال له, he said to him, لإسلامك أحب إلي من إسلام الخطاب لو أسلم. You accepting Islam today is more beloved to me than my father would he have accepted Islam. لأن إسلامك Because your acceptance of Islam كان أحب إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من إسلام الخطاب The same exact, similar Because the Prophet would love for you to be a Muslim more than my father Ibn Taymiyyah إخوة says ومن أصول أهل السنة والجماعة محبة أهل البيت That you love the family of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم ولم لا يا إخوة ولم لا Imagine the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم one day he called أبو علي called أبو فاطمة الحسن والحسين a famous hadith in the sunnah called hadith الكساء the cloak and he placed them under some sort of a garment and he said هؤلاء آل بيتي those are my آل take care of them please وقال في الحديث الآخر أذكركم الله في آل بيتي I remind you by the rights of my آل my family I am calling upon you by Allah all of these are commands in the Sunnah. It's not like something that you have a choice over. You have an option. لا. We must love آل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Respect them. Honor them. But the righteous and the pious of them. But that love does not drive us to give them a status over their what? Human status. خلاص. هذا هو الطريق المستقيم. طيب من هم آل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ لأن there is a debate between us and أهل الشيعة الروافض in this area. The classification of آل النبي, they don't agree with us. First of all, for us, آل النبي, of course, the core are those whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam called and placed under the cloak. Ali, Fatima, Hassan, and Hussein. Those are what? The core. But what about the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Do the Shia agree with us on this? No. The only verse in the Quran that talked about the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was mentioned in context of talking about the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرُكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to remove a rijs, the impurity from the household of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This verse was mentioned in context of talking about the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just go and visit Surah Al-Ahzab. Ya ayyuha al-Nabiyu qul li azwajika in kuntunna turidna Allah al-hayata al-dunya wa zinata fata'alayna wa matta'kunna wa usarihkunna sarahan jameel. Ya nisa al-Nabiyu ma ya'ti minkunna bifahishat mubayna yudha'af laha al-adabu dha'fay. Ya nisa al-Nabiyu lastunnaka ahadin min nisa. And then the whole actually context of the verses are the Shia, they say no, the wives, that's why they go after who? After the majority of them. Top of the list is who? Aisha. طبعاً عنا beside the wives and الحسن والحسين وفاطمة وعلي باتفاق آل عقيل. عقيل is the brother of Ali. آل جعفر. جعفر is the brother of Ali, the one who was killed in the battle of آل, meaning his family, يا إخوة. آل الحارث ابن عبد المطلب العباس. And those who are owned by them, meaning their مولى. Like if there is slavery and they are owned by them, they belong. Why, يا إخوة, this is important to know? Simply because you're not supposed to give them صدقة, right? You're not supposed to give them what? صدقة or زكاة. You can give them a gift, but صدقة, they are not supposed to accept صدقة. طيب, are you ready to go over the story a little bit, a portion of it? We have to start a little bit early, but من عقيدتنا يا إخوة, from our belief that we don't indulge into that fitna much. But it's important. Because Ali ibn Abi Talib رضي الله عنه, the father, was bit before al-Husayn by the people of Iraq. By the people of al-Kufa. He was bit by them. We know right after Uthman was assassinated, killed in Medina. At the hands of people from Iraq and Egypt, to be fair, and some from Yemen. They are not companions. People, rebels, people who are thirsty for money, for power. They came and they killed Uthman in Medina in a cold blood in his house. After they put him under siege, even water. Uthman, the one who given water to the people of Medina, he bought the well of Rumiyah for the Muslims. A lot of the companions became so angry and upset. And the majority of them were in Mecca performing Hajj, because those rebels, they came after Hajj immediately and they assassinated Uthman in Medina. A lot of the companions were still in Mecca, did not make their way back. The news got to them, they got so sad. They felt guilty that they did not prevent this from happening. But why they didn't prevent it? Because Uthman told them, I'd rather die, but not for the blood of one Muslim to be shed because of me. So compare this and Assad now, or one of these tyrants that we have. Uthman, Muawiyah, by the way, he was in Damascus, in Sham. He said, I'll send you an army. He said, no. In any rate, under pressure, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu took on the leadership of the Muslims. Under pressure, he didn't want it. Immediately the companions demanded from Ali the vengeance for the blood of Uthman. We need you right now to bring these guys to justice. Ali radiallahu anhu had a different opinion. He said, let things settle down a little bit and I will do this. But right now these guys are all over Medina. Wait until they go back to their homes and we'll bring them back to justice. And by the way, as Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we believe that this is the right opinion. But this does not qualify us to go after the Sahaba, after Aisha, after Zubayr. La. Because they were demanding justice for the killing of a Muslim, especially Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, kana waliyu ad-dam, lin Uthman from Bani Umayyah. Uthman is Amawi, Muawiyah is Amawi. Muawiyah is the one who is entitled, normally in the Arabian tradition, the head of the tribe is the one who demand the ransom or the blood of someone who was killed from the tribe. He got two opinions. A group from the Sahaba who were driven by compassion, passion, vengeance, vengeance. Ali ibn Abi Talib, wisdom. You know, leading people is imaming people is not, it takes, and ya ikhwa, there is no black and white in politics. There is no black and white at all. It's assessment of what is known in our shara, masalih, benefits, and what? And harm. And you could make the wrong call. And this is why, look, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we stand firm and say all the Sahaba, even though they ended up fighting one another, the number of Muslims who were killed in the fights that took place, what is known to be civil war between the Sahaba, is more than the number of Muslims who were killed in conquering the non-Muslim land. You believe this? But yet we stand firm and say what? All of them had a good intention. All of them had a good intention. But فعائشة رضي الله عنها الزبير Talha and another list of companions, when they saw that Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu is not going to take immediate action to avenge the assassination of Uthman, a communication happened with the people of Kufa. Again, the same thing. Come, we'll help you, Basra, or Kufa, that area, Iraq. Come, we're going to help you take vengeance. Ali ibn Abi Talib followed Aisha to Kufa, to Iraq, to stop this from happening. Two battles, ya ikhwa, took place. Safin, al-Jamal wa Safin. Al-Jamal between the Sahaba and Safin is between the army of Ali and the army of Muawiyah, because Muawiyah refused to give the pledge to Ali, the oath of allegiance. So Ali took his family to where now? Iraq. And just to show you that Ali was bit in the battle of Safin, Ali was about to finish the fitna once and for all with Muawiyah. He almost defeated the army of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. The fitna would have been killed and peace would have been restored to the Muslim world. But the army of Muawiyah did the trick. They raised on the tip of the swords the masahif, meaning that we're requesting arbitration according to the book of Allah. The people of Iraq in the army refused to fight. They said, we're going to stop. Ali said, no, let's finish it. They refused. They backed off. They disobeyed him. They walked out on him. That's why Ali was what? And a couple of years later, he was assassinated at the hands of one of al-Khawarij, Abdul Rahman ibn Muljam, died. After his death, around the year 40-something, al-Hasan became Amir al-Mu'mineen in that part. Remember now, Muawiyah still what? Did not give the pledge of allegiance to Ali. Al-Hasan, subhanallah, fulfilled the prophecy of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, my son is a Sayyid, is a leader. One day, Allah will use him to make peace between two fighting factions of the Muslims. 6 months later, he sent to Ali, thank you very much, I'm not interested in that. You're the Amir, here's the Pledge of Allegiance. He took al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he moved all of them back to Medina. Let's finish that chapter. ولذلك the Syria, ikhwa, is called the year of what? Amul ايه? Al-Jama'ah. The year of al-Jama'ah again, because the Muslims again body became what? One again. Because if al-Hasan did not do this, this would have been another drama. Can you imagine? For the first time, you got people giving pledge to Muawiyah and people giving pledge to al-Hasan. It's a continuation of what? Of the bloodshed, the civil war in the Muslim world. Al-Hasan died around the year 49 after Hijrah. 10 years almost later, 10 years later after he made that deal. Al-Husayn stayed. Al-Husayn, of course, saw all of this. By the way, Al-Husayn saw Safin, saw what his father went through. So he's already developing what? الحسين by the way is younger than الحسن 1 year. الحسن was born the 3rd year after هجرة. الحسين was born the 4th year after هجرة. 1 year between them. That's all. Things went okay. Muawiyah was treating them so well. آل النبي after this. He commanded for them to be treated. Don't even disappoint, don't even يعني give them any hard time. They just, he commanded the governor of Medina to take a very good care of them. Muawiyah رضي الله عنه nominated his son to be the Khalifa after him. Yazid. Towards the end of the year 60 after Hijr. Yazid is not a companion. Yazid was born the year 25 after Hijr, 15 years after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you're nominating Yazid, your son. When you have, look at this list of names. Al-Husayn, Ibn Ali, still alive. Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. Jabir. Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Tul Ashab al-Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jabir ibn Abdullah, Ashab al-Nabi. But they didn't like it. But again, Muawiyah رضي الله عنه did not violate anything. There is nothing in the Sharia that says you have to do this. He simply said, you know what? Instead of the Ummah, that's his judgment. Instead of the Ummah going into a bloodshed again, and who's going to be the Amir al-Mu'mineen, and Bay'ah, and not Bay'ah, and a pledge of allegiance, and all of this, let Yazid be my, the Khalifa, finish it. It's not haram. But certainly, as Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we believe that was not the right call. But again, this does not drive us to go what? After Muawiyah, like they do. Again, the middle way. Because this is again a judgment call. Like we said, in political Islam, there is no black or white. هو الرجل, يعني, he looked at the situation. We just finished, you know, a bloodshed. Let's just keep it quiet. My son takes over the Khilafah. Al-Husayn refused to take the oath of allegiance to Yazid. And Ali al-Nabi refused. They said, no, we're not going to do it. Muawiyah رضي الله عنه passed away. Yazid, the first sign of lack of wisdom right here, he demanded that oath of allegiance. Mahul Hussein refused to give the oath of allegiance, but they said, what? Go do your business. I'm not going to bother you. It's like, okay, I'm not going to support you, but I'm not going to harm you either. Just forget about me as if I don't want, I don't exist. If he would have been wise, he should have. But, and by the way, they are relatives. He is married to his cousin. He could have invited him later on or something. يعني, تعالى, let's talk about this. يعني, he could have done it. لا. He sent a letter to the governor of Medina forcefully. Al-Husayn must give you the oath of allegiance to me in the masjid tomorrow. One day after that letter reaches you. The governor of Medina calls Abun al-Husayn to his house. He showed him the letter. Tomorrow after Isha in the masjid, you have to give the oath of allegiance. No, yes, no, yes. He saw that there is a lot of pressure. Then he said, let me think about it. He goes home, back, all his family, after midnight, ran away to Mecca. This news got to who? To Iraq. Because so far Iraq don't like Al-Amawiyin. From the time of Ali. They were the core of the army of Ali. They fought against who? Muawiyah and they didn't like them. And they didn't give the oath of allegiance yet to Yazid. A lot of them did not. So they ended up communicating with Al-Husayn as soon as the news got to them that Al-Husayn refused to give the oath of allegiance to Yazid and he fled to Mecca. They sent to him, come to Iraq, come to Al-Kufa, we're going to take care of you. They sent him over 500 letters. Many delegations came to him in person. Come, we'll give you the oath of allegiance. You're going to be Amir al-Mu'mineen. And we'll support you, protect you, we'll take care of you. They tell you in these 500 letters, from 18 to 20,000 oath of allegiance, individual oath of allegiance, because every letter may be 1,000, 2,000 signing. Like 100 people signing in one letter. Oath of allegiance to Al-Husayn. Your Amir al-Mu'mineen, come, come. He decided to send his cousin, Muslim ibn Aqil. Aqil, the brother of who? Of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Muslim is his cousin. Go and verify that information. Muslim arrived in Al-Kufa, ya ikhwa, as soon as he arrived, in 2 days, he gathered 12,000 more oath of allegiance. And not only this, these 12,000 are representative of 30 to 40,000 members of the people of Al-Kufa. He got so excited. He immediately sent a letter to Al-Husayn in Mecca. Come right away. Don't delay. This happened in what month? Around the 10th, the 15th of Dhul Qa'dah. Watch these days now. Dhul Qa'dah, Dhul Hijjah, and then what? Muharram. Watch the dates now. Because this is important. Who found out about this? Yazid. That there is a plot for Al-Husayn to come, and the same scenario will be repeated again. Which Al-Hasan what? Finished. Politically, yani, when he resigned, another fitna will be implanted. He chose the most vicious human being, the most unwise human being, who was at this time the governor of Al-Basra, whose name is Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, ibn Abi, that's how he calls himself, Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. He went and he kicked out the governor of Al-Kufa, the one who all this happened under his watch, and he took over governing Al-Kufa. And now the main task is to kill that fitna. Who's going to be looking for now? Whom he's going to be looking for? He's after Muslim ibn Aqil. I need Muslim ibn Aqil arrested right away. Muslim ibn Aqil was hiding in al-Kufa. He did something very interesting just to show you, subhanAllah, this guy was 28 years old. Hot-tempered. His job, his vision is to just, you know, get on the ranks of position with Bani Umayyah. Like he just want to be what? You know, like somebody, I want to be the president, regardless now what, you know, I want to be the... He's thriving for this. It doesn't matter whether I end up harming the grandson of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So he put a good, according to him, yani, a successful scheme. He got one of these of his guys to pretend that he is bro Al Bayt against Bani Umayyah, Yazid. And he's bringing a lot of money from people in Al-Kufa, people in Damascus, to be given to the head of that person, the head of the one who is leading that scheme. So he arrived Al-Kufa as if he's coming from Damascus, and he has a lot of gold with him. And he was instructed to deliver that gold to the one who is managing that pledge business to Al-Husayn. So he needed to know who is the head of this. Because so far, Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad doesn't know who is cooking all of this. And he thought that Muslim ibn Aqil, you're familiar with these names, right? Muslim ibn Aqil would be hiding in the house of this man. Or at least this man knows where Muslim ibn Aqil is hiding. So gold and silver and money got him through. He reached a man whose name is Hani or Hani ibn Hani ibn Urwa. And subhanAllah, this man, you know the concept of taqiyya. You know what taqiyya is? Huh? Taqiyya, that you show something, but in your heart, what? That's a Shi'i principle in their theology. So he was a hidden Shi'i, yani bro Ahl al-Bayt, anti-Amawi, but he was showing that he's bro Amawi, bro Yazid. Immediately, as soon as Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad found out who he is, he arrested him. You were pretending that you are our guy, you know, you're bro us, and now we found out that you're cooking all these things. Where is Muslim ibn Aqil? He said, I don't know. He had the guy who went and delivered the gold to him behind the curtain. So he came out and said, what do you say about this man and the gold that he received from him? So he couldn't deny. The news got to Muslim ibn Aqil, ya ikhwa, that he's about to get arrested. Look at this now. Look at this. He sent a cry call to the people who given him the pledge, come and help me. Remember I said 30 to 40,000. How many showed up? 4,000 to help him. They went and they stood in front of the palace of the governor, free the guy inside, and he get out of here. SubhanAllah, this Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad, in 12 hours, he paid them off, somehow, threatening them. He just got the head of these tribes, giving them money. At the Asr time, At Asr time, Allah, ya ikhwa, this is from the books right here. Muslim ibn Aqil looked behind him, he only saw 70 standing with him. He lit Salatul Maghrib, he looked back, he found 10 in the line. So he decided to go on to a place called Kinda, that's the most bro, Ahlul Bayt tribe in Iraq. Those 10, they walked out. Yeah. He got arrested. But subhanallah, ikhwal, he was from Ahlul Bayt also. He's the cousin of who? Al-Husayn. The man whose name is Al-Ash'ath. Abdul Rahman ibn Muhammad ibn Al-Ash'ath, the leader of the army who arrested him, or the Sariya, the squad who arrested him. And he said to him, Muslim said to him, I don't care what you're going to do with me. Whether you're going to kill me, but you promise me right now that you're going to send a message to Al-Husayn, a letter to Al-Husayn, not to come to Iraq. That the people of Iraq are going to let you down, and this will be the cause for your death. You promise me this. No. Subhanallah, ikhwa, on the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, they took him to the top of a mountain, they cut his head. That's how they used to do it. And they throw his head down, then his body. They killed him. They tell you that he was standing on the top of this mountain. Yuhallil, la ilaha illallah, astaghfirullah, alhamdulillah. Allahumma qdi baynana wa bayna shi'atina. Oh Allah, you're the judge between us, Ahlul Bayt, and those people who let us down. So far, ya ikhwa, and inshallah we're going to stop here. Yani that's a good place to stop. But so far, Al-Hasan, all what he received is the message from Muslim earlier. You need to look at the geography here. Iraq, Medina, huh? And also Damascus, Isham, because that will come in action here maybe tomorrow, inshallah. The messenger that Muslim, the letter that Muslim sent when he arrived earlier just got to Al-Husayn on the 8th of Dhul Qa'dah, one day before Muslim was executed. So the message Al-Husayn received was what? Come, don't delay. The people of Al-Kufa are, I compiled 30 to 40,000 oath of allegiance for you. Come. So Al-Husayn is about to leave. Based on that message. Of course, the news that he was executed and all of it did not even get to him. In some of the stories, he sent people, messengers after him, and they were executed too. He decided to collect his family, Ali Nabi, and back to where? To Al-Kufa again. Who stood in his way? Ashab al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Jabir, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. His brother, Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyyah, a brother but not from Fatima, from another wife of Ali. Don't go. Because they have seen what happened before. The civil war that shook the Muslim Ummah. But he showed them, look, he actually carried these letters that they sent to him earlier on two camels. Look at these letters. And look at the letter that I received from my scout, the one that I sent to verify. I can't let those people down. And al-Husayn also thought that if he does not leave Mecca and go and somehow take action, Yazid is going to chase him in Mecca. He's not going to let him in Mecca. That's his judgment again. That's the judgment of al-Husayn. That if Yazid decides to stay in Mecca, I'm sorry, al-Husayn decides to stay in Mecca and not go to Iraq, to Kufa, Yazid is not going to leave him alone. He's going to, like he demanded him to give the oath of allegiance in Medina, he's going to do the same thing in He said to the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, I don't want a bloodshed in the Haram. And you know what? 2 years later, they did this with Abdullah ibn Zubayr. There was a big fight in al-Haram. فالحسين wanted to move out of Mecca to a, يعني, to take the fight out. But yet the Sahaba, their opinion, but again, يا إخوة, this does not mean that the Sahaba think this, that they are pro-Yazid. لا. Again, the reading of the situation is different to the reading of the situation of al-Husayn. That this is dangerous, this is not good for his family, not good for himself, not good for the Muslims. That's their opinion. But this does not mean that they love Yazid. And when we say this, this does not mean that we love Yazid over al-Hasan. Abdullah, the son of Imam Ahmad, asked Imam Ahmad one day, should we love Yazid? You know what he said to him? Anyone who has left over Iman in his heart cannot love Yazid. But should we curse him? No, we don't curse him. لا نحبه ولا نلعله. وذاك, you find Shia, when they come to you, by the way, they come and say, okay, what do you say about Yazid? They come to us, what do you say about Yazid? He wants you to, the kafir, ملعون, لا لا لا. We don't like him. We don't love him. Because he was the head of the scheme, but we don't curse him. Inshallah, we stop here. Huh? We continue tomorrow. But remember, because we cannot trace a lot of that stuff back. So we're going to build from now. Al-Husayn is about to leave to Al-Kufa. And that is the massacre is going to take place in Karbala, which took place on the 10th of Al-Muharram. Inshallah, we continue tomorrow. بإذن الله تعالى. جزاكم الله خيرا. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والحمد لله رب العالمين. Don't forget to pray شروق إن شاء الله.